Research Video Blog. I'm your host, Jim Jockel. Joining me today, Dr. David Eliezer, Vice President of Model Validation here at Numerix. David, how are you?
I'm okay. How are you, Jim?
Thank you for joining us. Following up on model validation, the oversight area which you are in charge of, really has come back into the limelight yet again. We've seen some significant trading losses into the market, new reflections on pricing models, and even as early as this past August, further guidance from the OCC on as it relates to supervisory observations and guidance around model validation, building off the 2004 directive of MiFID and the CRD directive in 2006. One of the key elements that I really want to dive into around validation and is around this concept of what is transparency. Can you give us a solid definition when it comes to pricing models? How would you define transparency?
A transparent model is something where I don't need to look at your code, but if you tell me what you've done in just a few words, tell me what equation you've solved, tell me what expectation you're evaluating, tell me what you've done, then I can go and implement it, okay, and I don't need to see your code and we can get the same number. Maybe not, you know, maybe my code performs more slowly than yours or does it different, uses a different numerical method entirely, but we should get the same number, all right? And it's then the testing of that model is straightforward, right? Because we can check whether you solve the equation and so on. So the test even can be made transparent. I don't need to say that I moved it there and it looked reasonable. Very often people do kind of reasonability tests, and exactly what they consider reasonable, that's not transparent, right? What is transparent is, you know, I test a mathematical identity, for example, or I make it very clear exactly how I'm, exactly what criteria I use to pass or fail.
So within that regard, we can argue there's probably five basic elements that go into a validation.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Looking at the market parameters, the configuration parameters, mm-hmm. The implementation of the model itself, mm-hmm. The assumptions and approximation, the deal representation, and then finally, of course, the source of data and, mm-hmm. and yep. Many issues and well-documented and discussed issues around market data.
Yep.
And we can talk about all these different areas in different segments, but I really kind of want to talk about the model implementation at
mm-hmm.
this point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And in a discussion in a recent presentation I watched you give, you were talking about examinations for code and best practices around code in the model validation process. Perhaps mm-hmm. you can give us a little bit of an insight of the way you recommend organizations look at code implementation and testing within mm-hmm. that environment.
Okay, well, I think the first thing to think about with code bases, and we're talking about mathematical code bases specifically now, is that code bases like these have a kind of a life, and they can, you know, the state of the code can deteriorate, and you can see that a code starts to decay and deteriorate by various symptoms, like certain people or programmers are afraid to go into the code. They spend more time fixing bugs than they do developing new code. It takes a very long time to add a new feature to the code because the programmers have to be so careful because nobody knows what's going on inside the code. If there are bugs that are long-standing that nobody knows how to fix, but they just sort of work around them. If you use workarounds on top of workarounds on top of workarounds, you know, eventually that code base is going to drown in bugs, okay? So what you need to do to maintain this, and this is really before the process of model validation, this is really bug prevention rather than bug catching, right? Bug prevention means that you have segmented layers of code. The most basic code sits in one library, and it has tests that guarantee that every component, unit tests, that guarantee that every component functions the way it's supposed to function, and it should have each one should have a very clear interface so that no mistake can be made as to what the behavior of that function is going to be. No one should be surprised if there's a side effect, because it's very well documented and very obvious that it's going to produce a side effect. You know, models that don't have functions don't have side effects should be, you know, somehow indicated that they don't have side effects. Then functions, you know, so, and mathematical code in particular, needs to take advantage of this, because mathematical code is the most difficult type of code to debug, because these symptoms of bugs can be extremely subtle. A number can be off just slightly, and that could be wrong. But it's the easiest code to test, because there are all sorts of identities. The identities are so strong that I can guarantee you that if it passes certain tests, it can't be wrong. Okay? So if you guarantee, if you make that lowest layer have all the, this layer of protecting tests, then the upper layer should make sure that it never inlines that functionality, but always calls the lower layer of functions. Don't, even though there's some optimization that's present that you could make use of to make the code faster, that would, you know, let me inline this call to the Q norm or this matrix inverse, don't do it.
So let me ask you a question now, right? So that sounds all well and good in a very non-dynamic environment. How are institutions supposed to manage, you know, the demands and needs of the front office, the traders, you know, where, you know, perhaps there isn't the rigorous elements of documentation within the code, or there's leakage within the code and rot over time, but yet that process has been going ongoing for many years, where things are getting built upon or worked around. What are some of the ways institutions can better manage that kind of time to market and competitive edge that?
Well, this is sort of what I was trying to get at. There are parts of the code, even you know, option pricing code that has to be gotten out the door in 10 minutes, there are parts of it that are eternal. You know, a Kolesky decomposition does not change next year. Get that into the lower library, get it reliable, make sure that it has a clean interface and it's always working, and then your guy who needs to produce this price in 10 minutes has something he can call. He doesn't need to inline it or write it himself or anything like that, right? Make sure that he has a library of functions that he can call, and that library is absolutely reliable and its interface is clear, all right? Now, when I come to the code that I need to turn around rapidly, I want as little of the mathematical logic in that layer as I can. I want as much of it, I want him to be cobbling together a string of, you know, of these lower level library functions whose performance I know is correct. Okay, if I give him a good library of components that he can use, then instead of having to write this much code, he writes this much code, and it's known to work.
Thank you, David. And clearly this is, you know, as we're seeing institutions bringing pricing models alongside their risk models, you know, and going to single models from front to middle and back, you know, that's going to become much more challenging and much more important in terms of overall risk measures and implementing over the overall profitability of the firm. So, David, I want to thank you. I know we're out of time. We have four more areas to discuss. I hope you'll join us again, and we can get a little bit more deeper into your thoughts on the market parameters, configuration, model assumptions, approximation, deal representation, and data. And we want to hear what you have to say as well. Please join the conversation. Feel free to follow us on Twitter at NX Analytics, or stay in touch with us on LinkedIn to catch all of our updates and the ongoing conversations. And we want to hear from you and make sure we're talking about the topics you want to talk about. With that, David, thank you, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.